Mike O'Mara, Radio Entertainment.
Today's episode of The Mike O'Mara Show is brought to you by our bonus packages. Please go to MikeO'MaraShow.com and click on the bonus banner. You'll get access to all of our bonus content, and even better, you'll be helping out TMOS. So please, quit sucking, and we thank you.
Available on demand every day in iTunes and the Google Play Store, and around the world on MikeO'MaraShow.com. What more can we do for you? It's The Mike O'Mara Show.
Right before we came on the air today on the Mike O'Mara Show, and thank you so much for joining us, we were discussing what is rapidly becoming something quite popular online. And I noticed it a couple of months ago, but especially during the quarantine, it seems to be permeating our news feeds. I get it on I get emails from it almost every day, and that's the new Nextdoor threads
that I'm actually joining right now because Oscar told me about
DC,
it. I didn't know about it.
DC, Washington DC was one of the first cities in around 2015 to get Nextdoor, if I'm not mistaken, 2015, 2016. And it's like a local message board. That's all it is. But they made it into an app, and now it's location based. So you kind of have to live in the neighborhood to be on the actual listserv or message board for your neighborhood. And Mike is right that as of quarantine, COVID-19 times, people are actually using it more. And the S they put up there is either unbelievable, or it is monotonous, or it is funny, or it is actually informative. So it depends on what you're looking for, but it will, like, you think your Facebook thread kills some time? You can kill some time on Nextdoor for sure.
And with mine, like, for example, yesterday I get 6 emails from them yesterday with little bullet points, little news things. Mm-hmm. And there are threads on there, too, right,
yes,
where people can give
a thread.
So you're
just getting an extension of the app. So you probably have the app, and they have your email, so they're shooting you emails for, like, what's new or alerts. So trending, they have a trending button on the app. Trending yesterday in my neighborhood was, like, who's leaving the dog poop on people's steps? And then stolen packages, or even worse, you think you got a delivery, but what was supposed to be inside is gone, and it's gone before it actually arrived to your house because you saw it dropped off on your Ring video doorbell. That's very popular when they send the video up to Nextdoor and say, this package arrived empty. And I feel bad for the FedEx guys because I'm like, I can't imagine the FedEx guy just stealing all his phones. It's probably happening at, like, the main warehouse or wherever else before it even arrives.
Yeah. Right. Uh-huh. You know, of course, when you're looking on these things, though, when you try to read, you can't, because they're all so scattered and there's so much verbiage on there. I am trying to,
Tanko,
get the thread.
Tanko in the Exeter neighborhood needs a recommendation for siding.
That's the usual mundane stuff that you're getting.
Have a lot of, hey, lost dog, and then within minutes, found my dog. That's always fun to see. Be like, never mind, she was in the backyard. And you're like,
hey,
oh.
If anyone is looking for a productive hobby during our bit of downtime, the stream next to the trail by the elementary school is full of plastic. I saw a snapping turtle in a plastic bag. After my husband rescued this turtle, I've been picking up bags every time I pass.
But here it is, the difference between, you know what we'd be talking about if everything was normal? We would be saying, well, this is the kind of stuff you actually go out and talk to your neighbors about.
Sure,
but now,
sure.
Because we're all cooped up inside, a lot of people are doing. And by the way, after it's over, we're all going to be communicating this way anyway about different things. I'm going to give you the gist of what the thread was.
Okay.
So there's a person that is driving around in the neighborhood next door to ours.
Right.
That is spraying people from their car.
Spraying them.
That apparently is spraying washer fluid on joggers when they're running along. Now
this is a great gag. This is a great gag.
I wish
I
could find it. It sucks that I can't find it. I mean, it was there, that it's not there, and it's frustrating. But
Oscar, what you do is you turn the little spigot on your
dog. I've heard
it's
this
so
bit before.
Great.
Yeah.
Wonderful downtown. And
so
clean.
Yeah. So the reason I bring this up is this person talked about either their a sibling or a mother or a daughter got sprayed, and then this person was out jogging and they got sprayed, And then they identified the car, said this is criminal, it shouldn't be done. And the reason I bring that up, if you remember all of the stories that I've told over the nearly four decades I've been doing this little broadcasting thing, that I used to talk about my friend Joey Pasker and I being out in Joey's Datsun. That's how long ago it was. Mm-hmm. His little Datsun mini pickup truck. And he had, the great thing about Joey's is that Joey had little washers that you could actually turn around the washer fluid.
Yeah, like domes on the hood of your car.
They weren't even domes. It was more like a little disc that came out.
Oh, wow.
A little sphere that came out. And you could turn it. And it shot an actual pinprick-sized stream of water out, and we would go out in front of the ground round on a Friday or Saturday night after we'd been out. We weren't drinking or driving, though.
No.
And he would spray it on people coming out, and they'd be all buzzed, and they wouldn't know it was happening. And you want to talk about hilarity ensuing, just standing, you know, like there would be cars at the ground round waiting to pick people up. That's just the way it worked at this bar when it would let out.
Yeah,
and we watering were like we're waiting. Well, we were watering people. We didn't do it often. We didn't do it often, but I remember how much fun it was. The fact that Joey and I lived, through our formative years is still a miracle. When some of the driving that was done would be driving, you would see if they put cameras in our car and showed us back when we were 16 and 17 and 18 years old, and they showed us driving, and you were watching it in a movie, you say, well, which one is going to die first?
Well, there's still a contest. you can still weigh in.
Joey had his father's Delta 88, and I had my father's Satellite Sebring. And they're both these big, clunky dad cars with big engines. My father liked to go fast,
power,
too.
Power.
But we would flip a coin to see who got the oncoming traffic side of Route 2, and then we drag race up Route 2.
That's safe because you flipped a coin.
Mike, I don't recommend it.
This just in from our statistics department. You are entering your sixth decade of broadcasting.
No.
70s, 80s, 90s, aughts, teens, and now the 20s. That's six decades that you've broadcasted in.
Really?
Yeah, but I mean, when I really started in the 70s. You're right, I did.
Yeah.
Oh my god. Yeah, the very end of the. Oh god.
By the way, Tim wants to know. Anyone know what stores have flour right now?
Yeah, that's it. Oh, I can imagine what yours is like in Leesburg, like suburbia USA.
Right.
A lot of tutoring.
Meanwhile,
does anybody want a tutor? Does anybody know a Spanish tutor that has good internet connection? And you're like, everybody should.
Does anybody want a free Hitachi 10-inch single bevel compound miter saw?
Mike, you will get good deals. And this and look, to be fair,
it's free. You don't get a better deal than that, for God's sake.
People are getting rid of their junk, and it's dependent on your neighborhood and how good the junk is.
Right. Hey, is anyone missing a grocery delivery? If yes, please PM me a general description of your items, and I'll send you your items.
So, if you're a parent and you had not had the time to like really pillage your kids' toys that are now middle schoolers and they're just sitting in the basement,
sure,
there are toys for days. If I had a kid, it would have been the right time to have one because you could buy these like really elaborate dollhouses for If you pick it up, we'll pay you. It's the weirdest. It's better than Craigslist because these are real people in your neighborhood that are essentially giving their goods away.
Hey, you know, do you have the number for that dollhouse?
You want one?
I'm kidding.
your Elvis doll's in?
Yeah, I go. Yeah, Elvis. Honey, I'm home.
Hey, and honey, I miss you. Now, I just clicked on one of my emails, and then it brought all the emails from that same person up. I don't know how that worked, but it did.
That's probably the thread from the actual posting.
Yeah,
the poop guy is the best in my book right now because there's this guy in on the mean streets of Georgetown that will pick up his two dogs' poop, and then he'll walk, and he'll do this almost like a basketball move, behind the back pass to throw it on someone's steps. And
okay.
They have
that
him
is
on
really,
camera.
That's a jailable offense, in my opinion.
They have
especially the fact that he's doing it with a little bit of flair.
And five different houses, they have him on the Ring doorbell cams, And you could see him on five different days throwing it.
He goes behind the back with it?
Behind the back, flings it right onto their porch, like literally their stoop, and they can't get a good picture of this. One guy has some sort of video capabilities. He zoomed in, and then you see this pixelated picture of this guy in a hat. And like, has anybody seen this guy? He's leaving poop on everyone's stoop.
Tell you who's having a bad day, Mike, is Tom Morrow. Because Tom Morrow writes, "Hello, all. If you get a package addressed to Thomas Morrow, please reach out to me here. Thanks." So apparently, he's not getting any of his mail.
Wow. People suck. People truly suck. Well, that is a...
It's probably a bad time, Mike, and I'm sorry for cutting you off, to find a COVID-19-friendly nanny, whatever that means. Because I saw that heading, and I said...
Somebody with antibodies.
I don't know.
Sounds like they want a nanny. It sounds like they might want a nanny who's had it and is now immune. But even though they don't know, just like Rob's clip in the audio, but I was quoting that to everybody, where that clip you had, I would love you to retrieve that. If you could find that from what you had yesterday where people are talking about, they tell you to go out. They tell you to not go out. They say you have antibodies. You don't have antibodies. You know that one that you played yesterday?
Yeah.
Where it was the what we're living with. As soon as Rob played that on the show yesterday, this was the example of the information we're getting and why not only is this a horrible time, but the American public is so confused because we are being told so many conflicting things. I have reached – this is someone who believes in the scientists, believes in the doctors, believes in all those people, and I have now achieved – circuit overload. And you could go through, you can go through the news now almost on a daily basis, and you will get chloroquine, not chloroquine. Chloroquine mixed with Pepcid, the ingredient that's Pepcid AC. You will talk about the fact that pandemic could be worse in the fall. Pandemic could go away in the fall. Pandemic hit, you should stay at home, should not stay at home. It is starting to, that's starting to wear me out. One of the reasons that I freak out when I'm on an airplane is because I don't know. I don't know what's happening. I don't know what's going on. I like hard facts. And I'm not, by the way, I'm not impatient to get out there and do it because I still believe we should be stay at home. I think that's the way, you know, from everything I've seen that
except
helps.
Except for, like, if you're going out to exercise or play golf.
No, going
or
outside.
Like that,
I play
golf
outside. Yeah. I'm talking about go out to restaurants and go to crowded stores and sporting events. I don't think we should be doing that yet. But it's just weirding me. By the way, nothing is more pathetic, and this will dovetail into another thing I wanted to talk about yesterday.
Right.
There is nothing more pathetic to me than listening to a struggling business owner who has chosen to open up, who's got a CNN microphone in their face, and because of their overzealous governor, putting these people in this untenable situation where they don't know if they're going to kill people or they're going to die, or and it's truly making a decision between their livelihood and their life. It is. If you boil it down to that.
Or both could equate to the same, if their livelihood is their life, and if they lose their livelihood, that's it, you know?
But putting people in that situation before we have the evidence to know whether it's safe to do is, to me, one of the more egregious things. And I root for the whole situation to be fine, but I don't know whether it's going to be.
I was telling Rob that, look, even for a guy like me that has all the, we're lucky enough to have enough gloves, have enough, I would say these masks that we reuse, people are kind of have to send us stuff. I literally told Rob before the show, I said, I just want to get it, beat it, and then, God willing, have some sort of antibodies, if that even exists, but know that I already got it. Because it is a toll every day to, like, get out there and do this, and you're like, excuse me, like, did I touch something wrong? Or did I touch my face just now? Did I do this? Like, it is, it takes a toll. It does.
It takes a toll. And when I'm trying, I have moved off of the briefings that they have, and I'm going to be full disclosure here. Everybody knows my politics. I'm probably more intrigued now. Washington Post had an expose on the detail of the knowledge of this administration about this situation that I think anything prior will pale in comparison, if this is even partially true, of how much it was known. And if they're coming right down to it, saying that there were briefings given, and briefings unread, and even the oral presentations that were given were kind of impatiently dismissed, I think we got a real problem on our hands. When the dust settles and we look at this, you're going to go back and say, oh, wrong man for the time? Yeah, probably so. So,
anytime.
But that I believe that will all be settled.
And
down
in November,
the road.
God willing.
Hopefully it will
Mike
be.
Mike Howard Stern
in
came out and he officially endorsed Joe Biden. I saw that headline.
Well, I am officially endorsing Joe Biden, but it's no surprise to anybody.
I'm on the fence.
And if hey, Todd Moore, the big Republican loves
Captain
Donald
Moore,
Trump.
The skipper.
Captain Moore.
Skipper.
Captain Moore. A LED shot of the deck of your boat is not a picture of your boat. Right? What it is a flattering picture of a boat. I'd like to see what your boat really looks like. Okay? Because to me, it looks like kind of a hack bow rider.
Oh.
Sorry.
I don't know what that means. But
Mike, in, we have the updated press conference footage on how we should be careful during the COVID-19 crisis.
All right. Now, Rob's going to play this right now. He had this on the audio vault yesterday. This is exactly how I feel. And this is what's freaking me out. Listen to the way, I know this is a comedy piece here, but it rings true in that the information we're getting is confusing, to say the least.
You must not leave the house for any reason, unless, of course, you have a reason, and then you may leave the house. Mm-hmm. All stores are closed except those that are open. And all stores must close unless, of course, they need to stay open. This virus is deadly, but don't be afraid of it. It can only kill people who are vulnerable and also those who are not vulnerable. We should stay locked down until the virus stops infecting people. And it will only stop infecting people if enough of us get infected that we build immunity. So it is very important that we get infected and also do not get infected. I hope this cleared up any questions about what we should and should not be doing during this time. Please educate your friends and family with this information so we can remove any and all confusion surrounding this time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. That's the brilliant thing.
It's perfect.
That is so brilliant. Because it's so true with what we're dealing with. And there is so much unknown about this. And, one of the scariest facts that I hear again and again, they have never found a vaccine for a coronavirus. That mm-hmm. should scare everybody.
Oh, yeah.
But the good facts are out there, too, that, if you get exposed to this, the majority of people are not going to have a problem. They're going to get sick. They're going to get varying degrees of sick, but they're not going to die. But that doesn't take away from the fact that you have, we're up at the Vietnam War number right now, and we are about to pass it. We're going to hit that 60,000, as I said last week on the show. It's probably going to be more like now what we've talked about before, the mm-hmm. Upwards of 100,000 deaths when this is all said and done. Who knows? It's just so difficult.
And the hardest thing for
me. We're so informed, but we're so non-enlightened. That's what's frustrating me a little
bit. That is very well said. What I hate is the unknown. And you can spend all day staring at CNN or MSNBC, and they'll repeat all the statistics and what we have right now. But the big things that are unknown, no vaccine, don't know if it's going to come back, don't know if it's going to be affected by heat. And now they're saying
don't know if you're immune from it, if you get it.
Exactly. These are huge, huge things that they have no idea.
Let's go to the member of our cast,
Jess.
with a doctor, with multiple doctors in the family. What are you hearing? What is he? Do you guys talk about the prospects of where this thing's going to go?
Look, we have a family Zoom every week.
Are they jackhammering outside the studio in Washington?
I do, but that's my fault because I was tired of living like a vampire. So
right.
I took out a piece of insulation.
I thought it was somebody working in my neighborhood, but I think it's somebody
working
yours.
That's me. Shannon, will you put this back in the window when you get a moment, please? Thank you.
Fair, they needed to bring out the heavy equipment to clean what was left on the parking
deck.
As
I was saying, I need that back in
nothing
there
better,
when you get a moment.
By the way, for a broadcast at airtime than the jackhammer.
That's
a
good one.
Which is just like fantastic.
Aren't they supposed to be off, for God's sakes? You'll see now to the right of me, my beautiful wife attempting to put a piece of glass.
I can't see her. Could she duck into the camera
at
all?
She's coming right in. Ah, there we go.
There she is.
There we go.
There's that toned yoga arm.
You want right, see her tuchus? Let me go over the other way here and see how this works.
No, we don't need to see her tuchus. Thank you.
Way to go. There it is. Just like Jack Horner in Boogie Nights.
All right. I'm not objectifying you, Peach. Sex sells. All right. Oh, we got to go back this way. All right. I'm back. Okay. So as I was saying, family Zoom, they're hopeful, right? They're absolutely hopeful. They want, really what we want is some sense of clarity and normalcy. Is that even a word?
Normalcy.
They want it to happen. But it's hard for them to get past the idea that, and I sent you a picture this weekend, not to alarm you, Mike, but just to give you some context, of these hazmat suits that...
Yeah, Oscar sent me a picture of Jose in his gear that he has to wear on the front lines. By the way, a lot of people don't realize this, but, you know, Jose is on the front line in an ER setting for COVID in a hotspot, which is Boston, Massachusetts. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the exchange that I have with Oscar, just to, I hope you don't mind sharing this, Oscar, but Oscar shared the exchange that... that he had with Jose when Jose sent him the picture of the hazmat suit. And I was just so impressed by it because Jose, one of the quotes as he was going at it, he writes to Oscar, "Me in my full gear. It's actually very comfortable. Take care." There's the, if you want to know what special people do, special people in the most dire circumstances find a positive. And if you see Jose, I can kind of hold it up there and you can see the.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
There it is.
That's the hazmat suit that he's in right there. It's actually quite comfortable. I said that's the positive that people that are just heroes do. The real people that are going into battle every day. And so it's still to look, everybody can give lip service to want to thank our first responders, want to thank our frontline medical people. But I think that, by and large, then we get right back to the numbers game and our opinions as Americans, blah, blah, blah.
These are the facts. We're not going to have a vaccine. It'll be faster than we've ever had one, but we're just not going to have one for a while. People will get sick.
If ever.
Oh, I believe we'll have one eventually.
I hope so. Yeah, I hope so.
I would love to think so.
Everyone in my family said, worst case scenario, year and a half. Worst case scenario, right?
No, I hope you're right. Yeah. I think we've got the best minds in the world on it.
I'm here in a year, maybe a little less than a year. But the vaccine will be here. What's going to be tough is the reality of, and we're going to get back to it, we're doing it now, of getting back into work. You'll probably have a skeleton crew because that's what it'll have to be. Some people will come back. Some people won't. Some people are working better at home than they ever worked before. It'll just be an adjustment period. And then, by the way, on the outside, from the health factor, they're still learning every day something new about this virus.
Right.
So you can't just say the obese and those with diabetes or pre-existing past the age of 60 or 70 are susceptible. You just don't know yet. You don't know. Mm-hmm. And so that's the scary part. Now,
right.
The upside is, if this happened in the 80s, could you imagine the pandemonium if we couldn't connect this way? Or even talk to our families on FaceTime.
The unknown.
Right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we have this technology now that, yes, it sucks to be home. It sucks to go out with all your gear. Especially if you're in a part of the country where no one's really wearing masks and you're being ostracized because you're taking your precautions. I would say, don't worry about them. Just take care of you and your family. Do what's being asked, because these aren't just people that are overreacting. These are people that are dealing with this on a regular basis and saying, you know what? We found that if you wear a mask, that 75% of the actual, the transmission of this on both sides, if both people are wearing masks, the transmission of this virus goes down by 75%.
I think even more. Yeah.
I hope so.
Big effing win. Just wearing the masks.
Yeah, just wearing the masks. So do it. Speaking of that, when we start the show, when we come back, we will have to do... a little recount. Rob and I both went out and about yesterday to get supplies for the fam. And while we're doing that, let me just write. I'm on Nextdoor Vintage Trace. Does anyone have any acoustical tiles that I could send to Oscar? Because it sounds outside our studio.
I'll turn on
like
the gate.
Optimus Prime is doing Jumping Jack, start the show for Christ's sake.
It's the Mike O'Mara Show. You can listen to the Mike O'Mara Show at www.mikeomarashow.com.
Stay tuned for an outstanding entertainment program.
It's the Mike O'Mara Show.
Let's get down to business.
From the entertainment capital of the world.
It's the Mike O'Mara Show. Mike O'Mara, Rob Spiewak, Oscar Santana.
And now,
from his easy chair, here...
Here's Mike.
We are live from the Podcast Village studios in our nation's capital, Washington, D.C. This is the Mike O'Mara Show. TMOS to our friends from Tracy, California, to Blackwell, Oklahoma, to Grand Chute, Wisconsin, Boiling Springs, Pennsylvania, Mason, Michigan, and Canberra, Australia.
Australia, mate.
It's the capital, mate. That's the kiddies. Time in Kangaroo Day, once in Jolly Spring, big kid, fair Billy Bung under the shade of a coolie ball tree, and he sang as he walked and waited till his Billy Bung, you'll come a waltzing Matilda with me.
Anyway, Mike O'Mara's show is on the air now.
Do you think Australians hate that song the way you hate, like, Irish songs?
I love the song. I learned it very young.
Right.
Who knows? our show today brought to you by Cornerstone. Things are changing quickly in the mortgage industry, and Cornerstone First Financial has emerged as a leader and educator among their competitors. The team at Cornerstone First is committed to keeping up with the latest changes and working with you to make sure you get the best rate and program for all of your mortgage needs. They even offer their low rate guarantee, and because they are a lender and a broker, they can do it. If they can't, nobody can. Call my friend Mark Livingstone. Cornerstone First Financial today is number 202-625-1221. That's 202-625-1221. Excuse me.
Happens.
Wow. Or online. That carbonation. CornerstoneFirst.com. These changes in the mortgage industry are temporary, and when this pandemic is over, it's the housing industry that will bring the people out of this and bring the country and the economy back. Call Cornerstone First Financial. You know, I ask for music every day. That's certainly loud enough. That's very nice. I know we sometimes say not too loud. That's not going to come through on the show, that it's going to be blowing me out.
Oh,
of
no,
water,
you sound fantastic.
Thank you. For all your lending needs, Cornerstone First Financial, 202-625-1221 or cornerstonefirst.com. Personal attention from application to closing. And we thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Looking on next door. The neighborhood watch thing that I have, a picture of a coral snake. But it's not a coral snake. It's the non-poisonous version of the coral snake. There's a coral snake that's got yellow in it, and then there's a black and white and red. And black and white and red is the non-poisonous one, and that's the one we see. So, because we have poisonous snakes down here, in case you're wondering.
Do you have water moccasins?
We have water moccasins. We have rattlesnakes. We have pygmy rattlesnakes.
Those are smaller.
We have coral snakes, and of course we have the very invasive Burmese pythons that are massive and live in the Everglades and the Everglades. And they're all over the place. But I can't find the one about being sprayed. You know when you get a obsessive compulsive about a particular thread, and that happens to me more than I can even tell you on this show. It's just crazy.
In your new neighborhood, I know you were close to where you were, but in your new neighborhood, do you have like the wild little geckos, those little lizards running around?
Oh, anoles, they're called.
And anoles,
They are everywhere. Not as much in my old here as compared to my old place, but so getting out to the grocery store yesterday, I made a run. We're spending more money on grocery food than we have, like a lot of Americans, and there are many Americans that have trouble doing that right now because, the situation is going to get, unfortunately, worse before it gets better, and I feel for everybody that, you know, needs to get back to work if the government's not going to prop us up, and nobody knows whether they are or not. Still a lot of people going out to the grocery store, and I wanted to compare notes with both of you gentlemen.
Okay.
A style, and I saw it probably 5-6 times yesterday when I went out and went to the grocery store, and it's people without masks that seemed to be acting like, yeah, I don't have a mask, I don't need one. Doop de doop de doo. Have you bumped into any of that where you are? Not that they just weren't wearing masks, but that they almost were prideful.
Yeah.
In the fact that they were saying, F it, it ain't going to bite me.
It's I call it the douche patrol, Mike.
I see
joggers and I see walkers of dogs and I see people with masks, without masks. And the people with masks are respectful. The people without masks, they look at you like you're the jerk. Why would you buy into this?
And I think it's required now in Virginia. And I saw it yesterday at the grocery store. But here's the best thing I saw at the grocery store. a guy shopping like this. He had his mask on his forehead. He had a mask, but it was over his eyes because, what, he was uncomfortable?
You mean over, on his forehead, not
yeah,
over
he was
his
wearing,
eyes.
Yeah, he was, I mean, it was above his eyes,
also,
I should say.
Also, this weird thing happens, and this is just technique, and you get used to this, is when you're talking to somebody and they can't hear you and they say, what? You will go to your mask and pull it down to talk, which defeats the purpose of the mask.
Right, especially if you're talking.
Yeah, so I see this on a regular basis, and I'm as guilty as for the first few weeks as same thing, like pulling it down so I could talk.
Yeah,
you just have to project. You have to yell through the mask depending on how thick the mask is. Now, if you've got a spandex panty mask like Trip Affleck sent us, no problem. Yeah.
It amplifies your voice.
Yeah, but if you've got some sort of thickness, or God forbid your mom made one out of curtains, you got to really speak up.
I saw this in action yesterday, Mike, at the grocery store. There was an older couple, I'd say probably between 70 and 80, and the old man, this is all I heard as I walked by, and it was so great. He said, I said we don't need any more watermelon because we have some at the house. And he's yelling through his mask at his woman.
Now, one of the other great unknowns that I've been reading a lot about, especially being kind of keto, is this Western meat shortage that apparently these plants, when they shut down for a month, it F's up the food supply, and that's on the way. So we don't know yet whether we're going to have a meat shortage. But once again, you won't know until
it's too late.
It happens, and then there'll be the run, and then it'll be gone. That's the world we live in right now. But I'm reading about it, and people that maybe are thinking in advance of or have a freezer might not be a bad idea. I don't know.
Do you feel like if they're okay? Look, I hear, and this is me. I hear pork plant going down, and people like just closing up shop. I'm like, I was never really into the other white meat.
If I hear
like tenderloin or any like main cuts like New York strips going down, I may.
Smithfield New York Strip Company.
Oscar may not be into pork, but I'll be right back.
Okay,
I'll show you how into pork.
Okay,
all right.
Yeah.
Now I
pork
feel,
is great, but
I feel
also
for the people there. Clearly, like I'm not dead to that.
But also, Oscar, if pork is off the shelves, that means that your pork eaters are going to start buying your beef. And that means the beef is going to go into short supply.
I'm probably in the minority because I don't have an oven.
We don't really cook. Well,
right?
Unless you made like steak tartare, foods, like, sushi.
Tell me that the granola bars are going out of stock and that plant got infected. I'm upset.
I think Smithfield makes pre-cooked bacon. That could affect you.
Yeah, but I'm not a big baking guy. I don't have enough at home to bake with, right?
What about tomatoes for a sandwich? Some lettuce?
I think we need an oven.
I am. There's an oven shortage. Sure, Rob, I am reasonably sure that this may be the funniest part of today's show.
Okay.
I will go one step further, say maybe the week, and perhaps even. No, it won't come close to Carrie. But let
no
me
one
just
does.
Say. Now, I was in the box store yesterday, and when Oscar says he doesn't like pork, I thought I would show you.
My God.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ. What do you got? Did you forget to celebrate Easter? What happened?
That's fantastic. Oscar, that is a full pork loin right there.
Yeah, that's for like a feast of 20.
What that is, that's like a deck of pork chops right there, ready to go at any given time.
Now, what's the one that closed down? The Swift Premium?
Right? Yeah, I believe so. At our Smithfield, too, wasn't it?
Well, Swift, I think, was one of the ones that...
Mike, there's a great sight gag you could do right now if you wanted to.
Well, I was trying to do it, but you were running your gab again. But that's what I was trying to do. I get it. It's just like, here, why don't you come here?
I see that, and it just looks like a lot of work.
Hi, how you doing?
It does look like your penis.
Pizza delivery.
You'll never guess why I got kicked out of Costco.
Yes, sir.
How much does one of those cost? Let me guess.
Hello, Mrs. Wormer. Mine's bigger.
A pork loin like that
is
to like $23, $24.
Oh, man, did it scrape off the price here?
Right?
Hold on.
Actually,
$24.
Really? You were very close.
See?
Yeah. $14.
I know. $14.
$14. That's, they're giving them away.
My mom.
$14.
Was so
That's
cheap.
Priceless.
She used to make me go look for the cheapest meat. The one that was gray and looked like it wasn't ready to go.
Needs to sell today.
Yeah, and she's like, go look for the cheapest meat. And in Spanish, she would yell at me. I'm like, Mom, I don't know why we have to buy cheap meat. Like, this is killing me. And then you'd have to pick out the kidneys. Oh, and you're like, oh, Mike, that's a gag reflex waiting to happen. Jesus Christ.
Oh, my God.
So I know what meat
costs.
Don't
worry. Don't worry, lady. It wouldn't have lived anyway. All right. That's terrible. That's an old line from my father. That's
a great punchline, though.
That's terrible. That is terrible. That is really gross. Isn't that gross?
So how many did you pick up? Three of those, four of those, or just
no,
one?
No, I got one of those, okay, and I got one of them. The beef one's fair. Insane. Insanely expensive. That's the part. That is my luxury purchase of luxury purchase, but it lasts, I'm going to say, but it lasts so long. No, it doesn't. No.
You cook it all at once,
keto?
Right?
I've got to stop eating.
That loin, you can do several meals out of that, and also it's very versatile. It's great. It's lean, cooks easy. It's nice. You have to sear it before you cook it, though, Oscar, because it is
this
so
is
lean.
This is a pork loin, boneless, from Kirkland. Thank you. Thank
so
you
good.
Very much. Yeah, it's 7.73 pounds.
I mean,
let's call it 8. But what we were talking about when you stepped away, Mike, is that. Oscar
loving
says
it
the,
and hugging it.
Then that's not what he's doing.
No.
The pork shortage wouldn't affect him because he doesn't.
It's
I don't know
wonderful
how he plays
day
basketball.
In the neighborhood. A wonderful day.
Does that affect your swing, Mike?
No, but it keeps me out of certain restaurants when I'm wearing my nylon shorts.
Hi-oh!
There we go. That's so disgusting. That is just. I apologize. I truly apologize.
Oscar says that a pork shutdown won't affect him, but don't you feel, Mike, that when the pork is off the shelves, the pork purchaser will go to beef, go to chicken, go to turkey, and that's what's going to cause the run on meat?
They're just saying the food supply chain might be disrupted. So I don't want to alarm anyone. That's not what I do on this show. I try to entertain, like pretending that my giant pork phallus is something that we can have here. All right?
Your GPP, Mike?
John Bon Jovi. Yeah. Yeah. That's a better.
There you go.
Hey, what is that? All right, we'll take a break. Come back with more on the Mike O'Mara Show. WABE! Welcome back to the Mike O'Mara Show. For all our sakes, we need to avoid crowds. And let's go into the stamps.com.
You had to buy the big one. You had to buy the big one.
NH. No help. For all our sakes, we need to avoid crowds any way we can. But what if you needed postage to send out letters and packages? Have no fear. Stamps.com is here. Yes, it's Stamps.com. Anything you can do at the post office, you can do at Stamps.com. Print your postage on demand and skip those crowds at the post office. No human contact required. It's that easy. And with Stamps.com, you get great discounts too. 5 cents off every first class stamp and up to 40% off USPS shipping rates. Plus, in addition to offering discounted U.S. Postal Service rates, Stamps.com now offers UPS services with discount rates up to 62%. And with Stamps.com, you don't have to pay UPS residential surcharges. Stamps.com is a no-brainer, especially now, saving you time and money and keeping you safe in these crazy times. Right now, our listeners get a special offer that includes a 4-week trial plus free postage and a digital scale without any long-term commitment. Just go to stamps.com, click on the microphone at the top of the homepage, and type in TMOS. For USPS or UPS, it's stamps.com, promo code TMOS. Stay safe, my friends. And you're all my friends. And one thing I didn't mention yesterday on the show, did I say that Kevin Hart is a good actor?
No.
No.
No, this is shocking news.
I watched The Upside, Kevin Hart's 2017 movie, I think. It was Bryan Cranston and
he's like his personal assistant, right?
Fantastic movie. Really, really, really good.
You know why you didn't know enough about it? Because during that time was when Kevin Hart had that controversy that he finally came around on about his old tweets.
Oh, and the homophobic tweets.
Yeah, and
that's right. And they kind of buried the movie, right?
So, like, he was supposed to go on the Today Show with Bryan Cranston and promote the. And this is chronicled in the Netflix documentary when you see him come full circle, which really makes you want to buy into Kevin Hart if you weren't a Kevin Hart fan before. Where he says
he really is great in this. I mean, a very great acting chops.
Cranston could literally said maybe their publicity team said maybe you shouldn't come on the show, or if you're going to go on the show, Brian shouldn't come because then you're going to be addressing this homophobic tweet the entire time, and the idea of even pitching a movie is going to be lost.
Right.
So, but that's how.
That's when that all went down. That's when
not enough people knew about this film.
I remember the reviews being good. And how much of it do you think is the fact that Cranston sort of elevated him? Because Bryan Cranston is incredible.
No, I mean, look, I'm not a big fan. I don't like loud comedians. I really don't, by and large. I don't. I like subtlety in my movie actors. And it just seems that when I think of Kevin Hart, I think of all the time. Mm-hmm. Manic. And this was, it played to his type a little bit. He's an obnoxious character at the beginning. But the nuance of the role was pretty good. I thought it was actually a decent job that he did, and I ended up being really engaged in the film. And Bryan Cranston does a fantastic job too. It's a simple story, and it's an old movie. It's about a guy that becomes the personal assistant to a quadriplegic, played by Bryan Cranston, and he is picked for the job because he's the most unqualified for the job, because Bryan Cranston is so depressed and such a contrarian in his own prisoner in his own body. He decides to go the opposite, and Nicole Kidman's got a nice role in it. And I just think it overall was a sweet movie. It was a movie I needed to see. So it's called The Upside. If you didn't see it when it came out in theaters, it's a great little movie to check out. So I recommend that with four thumbs up. That's very.
Is that the only kind of uplifting movie you've been watching during the quarantine, Mike?
I think I would describe it as revenge porn. I was talking about the fact that I've been watching I Spit on Your Grave, the series.
And people should know it's not literal porn.
Yeah.
Porn in a figurative sense. Yeah.
I want to give props again to Quentin Tarantino, though, because not only does Quentin Tarantino like to rewrite history and make the bad guys lose, I think Quentin Tarantino, having a few years to have watched Django and then digest it, and then going back and watching it again last night, take away the fact that it's a revenge story of revenge stories. I think what I loved about Django is that if you look at pop culture over the years and the time in our national history of slavery, I think what was great about Django is how brutally that time was portrayed. I think he did a great job with that. But, you know, getting besides that the slavery part of it, the actual pure revenge story of Django is, I think it speaks to my state of mind that I am gravitating towards stories. I know how Django beginning, you know, the beginning, middle, and end. I know what it's all. And once again, here I am watching one of the most nakedly violent films in the Tarantino arsenal.
Big smile on your face.
Hitting like a comedy arc or like 16 Candles or I don't know, something different. Like a John Hughes trilogy.
Maybe Tonight, Mike, Love Actually.
Love Actually holds up.
Yeah, but it's not really a revenge film. I don't know if it's on Mike's plate right now.
I think in Django, Tarantino really, really got the splatter factor where people are shot. You know, look, when you think about
Westworld,
our culture,
revenge. You're gonna love it, Westworld. This season of Westworld, all revenge based.
Really?
Oh my God, Mike, you're gonna love it.
I love the lady that's in Westworld.
It's the
She's
haves
lovely.
Against the have-nots, and that means souls against the people that don't have souls.
Right?
They're androids. It's amazing.
I only stop on Westworld when they're naked.
Like third season, completely different story arc. You don't have to watch the first two. Like they're out of
self-contained.
It's self-contained. It's in the future. It's effing awesome.
All I know is I turned it on for a bit. And there were about 40 Ed Harris's in one room. That's what I was watching.
Oh God, that's my fantasy. Because I love Ed Harris.
Lots
He's
of
the
violence,
greatest.
Mike. Lots of violence.
Django.
Yeah.
If you'll notice, like when the guy gets shot in the shoulder. It's like somebody hits a ketchup bottle because it's like, oh, and it's like splatter all over the body. It was, you know, and here's the thing. Leonardo DiCaprio, if you don't think he's a brilliant actor, Just playing that way. Oh, let's make some noise on my end, too. That's right. Mike's taping! That's right. Stay right here. There are only 700 homes in the neighborhood.
Others.
9 o'clock, it begins.
So for Tarantino, don't you think that revenge is sort of a running theme in almost all of his films?
Yes. Yeah, it is.
He likes
revenge.
That. He likes that
revenge.
And women's feet.
He likes, but I'll tell you, more gunfights, more blowed up stuff. It was spectacular. Really, really spectacular. And if you haven't seen Django, go back and look at that. Those are my two recommendations today for
what's The Upside? I haven't seen that.
Is worth it. I haven't really watched that much sweet stuff. And maybe.
Was there any revenge in the Kevin Hart movie?
Yeah, to a
really?
Certain
Oh,
well, he goes in and upsets the apple cart with all these she folks and
demand a bunch of ramps.
Yeah, it's interesting. He's a super rich guy. Kevin Hart comes from the other side of town, and they end up being pals. That's it. I was excited to watch that, and I was excited to watch Django. Probably not as excited as you were to get ESPN, Rob Spiewak, but
absolutely.
What compelled you to get ESPN
after all these years?
Was our brow beating?
Son,
is that what did it?
Well, no, it wasn't that, but it was just sort of funny the way it all came together. Robert said, "Dad, I really want to see this Michael Jordan documentary.
Oh, nice. The Last
Everyone's
Dance.
Talking about it, and I'd like to see it." And so I was going to call DirecTV.
Why do we do that,
Adam,
Robert, when we can watch My Fair Lady again?
He's never seen it, so it'd be for the first time.
He's never seen ESPN?
No, he's never seen My Fair Lady. I've sung him the score dozens of times. But I've never shown him the film.
I could have danced all night. I could have.
No, I said, so I'll call DirecTV and add it in. And because what happened is I had to do some pretty clever finagling with DirecTV the last time I had a throwdown with them to get Turner Classic Movies, because they changed their tiers. And Turner Classic Movies, next to the networks, that's my favorite channel. Mm-hmm. That's the one I needed. That's where I lost out on ESPN. And Robert said, "Well, you know, Dad, we can bundle Hulu and Disney Plus and ESPN for a deal. It's on the net." I said, "Okay, let's look." So yeah, I looked in, and we've got the smart TV, so it all works out. So for $12.99 a month, we're getting Disney Plus, and we're getting Hulu, which still sucks, and we're getting ESPN. And I said, "You know, this is great, because I would like to see the Michael Jordan documentary as well. Everyone
and
is talking about it."
And you want to see SportsCenter every morning.
Every morning. And, of course, there's all the Star Wars stuff on Disney Plus. I would be lying if I said that wasn't a factor. That's pretty cool to have all that stuff. But he wanted to see it. I wanted to see the Jordan documentary.
Yeah, you've never done anything, you know, where it's just purely for the good of others.
As you know, Mike, I hate my children.
Is it the same as a DVD of the Star Wars movies?
No, it's not as good as that.
Okay.
But I have all of them on DVD anyway. But I want to see that Mandalorian thing. That's
seen it? You're going to love it.
No, because Baby Yoda should be really
cute. You're going to love it. I've seen it.
But we couldn't watch the Michael Jordan documentary because there's a new show that's on about 9 hours a day called 90 Day Fiancé. And every time I turn on my DVR, there's a new episode of 90 Day Fiancé, and Carrie is addicted to this, and it might be the worst show I have ever seen in my entire life. They have broken men from America that fly to, say, I don't know, the Philippines to meet a woman they've been courting online.
I'd love to see that.
Oh, Mike,
they're all more attractive than the men.
Like, oh, absolutely.
These women, like, they would, you would never, these, I would say eights, some sevens, nines and tens, and these fours of dudes roll
up. Oh, fours. I'm going to tell you a little bit about Ed in a second. But before we get to that, Carrie is watching 90 Day Fiancé and fast forwarding through the commercials. And I'm thinking, this has got to be over soon. So I go downstairs and do some stuff on my computer. I come back up. It's still on. She clicks on. It's a 3 hour episode.
Yeah.
Every week. And then, Mike, add to that 90 Day Fiancé before the 90 days. And then there's a show where other 90 Day Fiancé couples watch it and comment live from their bedrooms. And
so
it's
the 90 day
industry.
Hold on. Calm down. The only thing about the 90 is the 90 days, how long it takes for the guys to like make the arrangements and travel to the location to get the mail order bride.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
In these COVID days.
Yes.
Like, they must have pre-taped this S.
Because they have to do a lot of flying and traveling to. Asia.
To war-torn Eastern Bloc countries.
Thank you, Ed. I will meet you at the wet market.
Will you join me for a bite of bat?
Oh, she is lovely, isn't she? Oh, I'm so happy.
Mike, Ed is about 4'10", and he has a big, gross beard. And the first gift he gave to Rose was mouthwash, because he says, "You're lovely, but your breath is not making me happy."
Oh, God. Oh, I want to hear more about this. And I'll tell you why my house sucks right after this on the Mike O'Mara Show.
That's Ed.
That's Ed right there. That's Ed. Oh.
Here's some
mouthwash. Concerned about fresh breath.
What is that? What's that on? 90 Day Fiancé. What channel?
I think it's isn't it Bravo? Yeah, I don't know. It's Carrie's thing.
Mike, you can get it on Netflix, no problem.
Yes. Oh,
looking right forward to it. Might be
TLC,
doing that
TLC, forgive me.
All right, wonderful. Welcome back to the Mike O'Mara Show. Hey, I've been telling you about my bookie. Stay sane, stay entertained with my bookie. No sports, no problem, because our friends at my bookie have you covered. There's no quarantine on fun, and it's not just video poker on my bookie. My bookie has live casino dealers online. That's right, my bookie has professional dealers at their tables, live on site 24/7. And sports fans, my bookie has partnered with some of the leading esports brands. You can watch NBA 2K20 and you can have fun with it. It's great. This brands, you can make your wagers on virtual stuff. I've signed up. I love it. We need this now more than ever. My bookie, you can trust an industry leader like my bookie. They are reliable, they're upright, and best of all, they pay fast when you win. Visit mybookie.ag and use promo code TMOS for a 150% bonus on your first casino deposit. That's promo code TMOS to receive more than double your deposit in cash bonus, all the way up to $750. Use promo code TMOS to activate the offer. Mybookie.ag. You spin, you win, you get paid. Woo! Ladies and gentlemen, woo-hoo! That's another picture of Ed.
Yeah, he's all over the, but Mike, don't, you can't sleep. You can't sleep on the other guys. There's another guy who's pretty sure that his fiance doesn't exist. Her name is Lana. And he's gone everywhere in, I think, Russia, showing pictures of her to people that she claims she knows, and no one's heard of her. So this poor guy hasn't even met
his
wife
yet.
Sounds like
you're digging this show, too. It sounds like you're enjoying it.
There's saturation. It's on all the time.
Every man's dream. And I would be lying to say that, look, it's also cultural, Mike. In some cultures, women hold their men up and they treat them like kings. And others, they, you know, cuck them and treat them like garbage and essentially make them feel small. In the Latin American culture, as you know, the man is king of his castle.
She's lovely.
She is, but bad breath.
So he's a monster.
So the guy.
She claims she had an oral ulcer. That was the problem with her breath.
The guys on these shows, they're just looking for that fantasy on the other side. Mm-hmm. Now, are they willing to travel for it? 100%. Are they willing to put up with a few cultural differences, like maybe dental care? Yes.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So things that you can fix. But the idea that they're going to put themselves on television, it makes me believe that they don't have the funds to do this on their own, because we've been talking about mail order brides for the last 20 years on the air. Mm-hmm. That this is the way that they're like, all right, the casting director says, you're a troll. You make a decent wage, but you're probably not going to spend the, 30 gur it takes to get over and then get someone to marry you.
$30,000.
I want to leave this show and go watch that show now. We ought to get paid by these shows. I swear to God. I'm so motivated to watch this right now.
And you're like, you're going to go. We'll cast you. It's like The Bachelorette. It's a free trip to paradise.
Right.
To go on a bunch of dates, and if you can put up with has sloppy seconds, thirds, or fourths, you can get some airtime. Your girlfriends at work are going to be jealous.
And then also, Mike, it's a wonderful exhibition of difference in culture.
And you can travel.
There was one guy who had to get permission from his mother, because there's an American lady, and she's handsome. And she's gone to some African country to meet her future spouse, but needs the permission of the future husband's mother. And the future husband's mother is not going to give permission, because she's afraid if her son goes into America, she will sell him into slavery.
Yeah.
This is the actual plot.
Mm-hmm.
Let me ask this. Is the basis for the story arc on this show, Is it for like so Ed and whoever, whatever the lady's name,
Ed and Rose
live happily ever after, or does it show these relationships disintegrating? How does it? What's the end game?
The thing is, it's a very long story arc because the show is 3 hours long and it's all season long. So they'll do like 20 minutes with Ed and Rose, then they'll do 20 minutes with David and Lana. And I don't know where Ed and Rose are going to end up right now because there's not, it's not complete on one episode.
Well, it also
it's ongoing.
Depends on when the current administration put in those border laws when they locked down the border.
Exactly.
Like,
yes.
Right.
Because they could get married, but still, there's just an immigration process.
Yeah.
So
well,
you come in on 90-day tourist visa and then. You got to see where you go from there, right?
Well, I saw the picture of Adam Rose, and I mean, really, isn't that usually supposed to, you're supposed to see that through to completion?
Well, I don't think Ed has seen completion in a long time.
And Rose just took up yoga.
Yeah. And also, there's the other plot, Mike. There's the Russian lady who is going to break up with the guy within the 90 days because he revealed he sold drugs 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And she has to tell the mom, and the mom is not going to be okay with it.
Who has to tell the mom?
The 90-day fiancé man from America that flew to,
The Russian mother?
Has to tell the Russian mother that he spent some time in the slam.
And is the Russian lady, is she attractive?
Yeah, most of them are. Most of the fiancés are attractive. I will give them that. Not all of the people that are courting them are all that great.
Also, yeah,
I have experience with those Russian relationships because usually the fiance waits until the marriage and they're one week old and they are over here in the United States. That's when they do the breakup. That's the
yes,
way that
exactly.
happens. Yes,
exactly.
I don't know that for a fact. It was just something a stripper told me one time.
Well, Mike, that's why it's on TLC because you're learning.
Yeah. It's a learning thing.
It is a learning thing. But anyway, the problem is I'm okay with the notion of the show and some of the moments of the show, but the fact that it's on for about 9 to 12 hours a week is too much. They need to compress it.
It's think about it this way, Rob. For The Bachelor, you've got two nights and it's essentially 4 hours of programming for two nights when it's on.
Mm-hmm.
And then in between that, you have Bachelor in Paradise.
Right.
And then, so you're right. It's similar to that where how do we build one product and then build a universe of shows around that one product?
Mm-hmm.
Like the prior, after, and then essentially own that space.
Right.
If you're watching it at nauseam, yeah, and look, Schitt's Creek, fantastic show, love it. After nine of them, I'm done with Moira for like a good 2 weeks. Like I didn't come back to a little later.
There's a saturation.
Yeah.
And very repetitive with the plot. You know, the same shtick all the time.
Unless
you know?
She's talking about fruit wine.
Right.
I gotta like it's tough.
I burned
to get
on
past
it early.
Yeah.
I burned out early. Yeah. You know, I mean I can't see Eugene Levy in another suit. I just can't do that. That's it. I get it. That's the way TV works. All right. You'll hear about my lemon house tomorrow. I'll save that till tomorrow. Sorry about that, but my house, yeah, really. I know Oscar's got his issues, but, you know, we thought things were new here. Not.
So,
anyway,
Mike, when you say lemon house, you're not, like, growing stuff in Florida?
Oh, no. Like lemon laws, you know?
Oh,
like
I'm with
for
you
a
now.
Car, like for a car that's a box. That's what it is. Yeah. Thank you. We'll take a break. Come back with news you may not need right here on the Mike O'Mara Show. Welcome back to the Mike O'Mara Show, brought to you by Harry's. Now is not the time to overpay for razors at the drugstore. Harry's knows sometimes it's better to stay inside. That's why they ship directly to you. Join the 10 million who have tried Harry's. Claim your special trial offer by going to harrys.com/TMOS. Harry's is a return to the essential quality at a fair price. Just $2 per blade. They make their blades in their German factory that's been honing precision blades for a century, which means you get incredibly high-quality blades. You never know when they're dull because they're never dull. At least that's what it seems like to me.
Right.
But, you know, I change them just when I think I should. But they're always sharp. It's amazing. They're great blades. Blade refills are delivered directly to your door on your schedule with or without a subscription. And they have a 100% quality guarantee. If you don't love your shave, let them know, and they will give you a full refund. And 1% of proceeds set aside for nonprofits, providing help to veterans and care for men. It's really a wonderful organization. Our listeners can redeem their Harry's trial set at harrys.com/TMOS. You'll get the weighted ergonomic handle for a firm grip, a 5-blade razor with a lubricating strip and trimmer blade, rich lathering shave gel with aloe to keep your skin hydrated, and a travel blade cover to protect your razor. Go to harrys.com/TMOS to start shaving better today. I would tell you more, but unfortunately, it is a 90-minute show. But thank you very much, and we truly appreciate it. And thank you, Harry's, for your fine sponsorship.
News!
News!
Boo! Well, you know, a ton of celebrities are taking part in a thing called The Call to Unite.
Yes.
This is going to be a 24-hour live stream where they're going to offer lessons, performances, poetry.
Okay. Poetry.
Meditation. You know, I shouldn't do that. I shouldn't be a dumb
DJ. Meditation's important.
Hey, poetry, man. Poetry's important to culture.
How's your Longfellow?
Hey, straighten out your Longfellow. Call me when you have no class. That's it. That's what I know about poetry. Meditation, dance, whatever they want to share. They'll also be taking donations for the COVID-19 relief effort. It happens live starting Friday at 8 p.m. Eastern, featuring, quote, over 200 global leaders. I'll start that again.
Please.
Over 200 global leaders, artists, entertainers, and community leaders. Here are the people that are involved. Oprah, Julia Roberts, Rob Lowe, Jennifer Garner, Quincy Jones. Oh, Jennifer Garner. I wonder what she's going to be doing.
Stretching.
I love Jennifer Garner. Quincy Jones, Deepak Chopra, Common, Alanis Morissette, Josh Groban, Naomi Campbell, George W. Bush, and Marie Kondo. Those are just some of the people.
No Kevin James?
Are involved in this, yes. I know you were hoping, Rob. I know you were hoping for Kevin James, but
yeah, no,
I don't even know. He might be involved. I'm not
because
sure. You know?
He's quite the poet.
Yes, he is. I know, Oscar, I think you're the big fan. Goonies, that's
movie? Yeah, love Goonies.
The cast of Goonies reunited on Zoom for a new show called Reunited Apart, hosted by Josh Gad. Just about everybody came back for it, those who are still alive anyway. That included screenwriter Chris Columbus, director Richard Donner, and even producer Steven Spielberg.
Wow.
Talk of a sequel did come up, and Steven admitted that he's been involved in trying to get one going. He said, quote, every couple of years we come up with an idea, but then it doesn't hold water. The problem is the bar that all of you raised on this genre. I don't think we've really successfully been able to find an idea that's better than the Goonies that we all made in the 80s. Until we do, people are just going to have to look at this one 100 times.
I know that's lip service, obviously, but are they batting around the idea of Goonies with them now?
So yes, I'm deep into this.
Okay.
Every time a story breaks out of like a potential script or a script that failed, I read about it. I hear about like the Goonies would have their own kids and then they would go on their own adventure and they would find their own Chester Copper Pot type of treasure. And it's recycled. And I really think this falls on Steven Spielberg because he probably owns the rights or whatever. He doesn't have to taint himself with this project. Like
right.
This is more for the Corey Haims of the world that need this project.
And you know it's a total ripoff of a Little Rascals short.
Well,
right?
I don't care about that. I'm just thinking about the Goonies side.
All right.
Would say that I'm not a purist. I want a new bad Goonies movie. I'll take it all day.
Like, okay.
Redo it with a new cast. That's fine. Cast that chick from Stranger Things. Throw her into this. But he doesn't have to do it. So they're not doing it. And it's never going to be perfect. Stranger Things is the Goonies reboot. That's
you're
basically,
right.
basically
it's exactly what it is.
Yeah.
Rocky Road.
What about a plot line where Chunk gets COVID?
He's definitely dying.
Your mom's Mother's Day wishes, the list is probably doable this year, even during the lockdown. 400 moms age 55 and under were polled. Well, what about the older moms? Anyway, here are the top 8 gifts they said they want to get. Gift cards, the top cards they want are for online retailers, big box stores, you know, everything like that. Flowers, personal care items, housewares, clothing, tickets to an event. Just make sure it's well into the future. That's dumb. I don't get that.
The 55 and under, was that an IQ for those mothers that they wanted tickets to an event?
Jewelry. All right, mom's
help me with the jewelry.
Well, my mom was older. I got her
just
a nice
like Moira
this one time.
That's right.
Hello, I'm Moira Rose. I love fine jewelry. Books up there. Books, fantastic.
Yes.
I'm reading a difficult book and I'm reading an easy book. And I'm talking about degree of literacy, where this book is, I'm trying to get to the bad part of it, where it's about a serial killer in Chicago in the 1800s, and I'm getting a history lesson,
Good Night Moon.
It's a, and then so I was in the box store the other day, and I snatched up a James Patterson, which I'll, by the way, I read on my last trip to the bathroom. A nice meal at a restaurant didn't make the list this year for obvious reasons. Thank you very much,
but
everybody.
They still want tickets to an event.
I once got my mom jewelry, and it was a big fail because some people get allergic when it's not real white gold or it's
you got like a plated thing or something.
It was from a nice store, and my mom, God bless her, but she does not mince words. She literally said, she goes, I can't wear this. I'm sorry, you're just gonna have to return it because it's not the. Like, I'm going to get a little gray.
Green, probably.
And I was like,
you send me something plated, Oscar. I can't. It's cheap crap. Send it back. Here's some quick hits for COVID. Apparently, a woman in D.C. was so scared of getting the virus, she pepper sprayed a bunch of people who tried to board an elevator she was on. Seems a little overdone.
Shannon.
To help out the potato industry. The potato. Potato. Oh,
this has been the worst year for potatoes ever.
To help out the potato industry, people in Belgium have been asked to double the amount of French fries they eat. Boy.
I lived in that country.
How'd you like to dip that in chocolate?
I tell you, I'm on keto right now. A French fry to me is just like that Swift premium pork loin I held up. All right, moving right along.
Is this what you'll see on your next flight? Air Asia debuted new flight attendant uniforms. I looked at them. They are basically hazmat suits with pretty colors.
Yeah.
But that's what they're going to be wearing on Air Asia in the new reality that we live in.
I don't want to read ahead, but do you have the American Airlines headline from yesterday?
I don't.
American Airlines now is going to give masks, or you should have masks when you fly on their airlines.
As you should in every grocery store and everywhere.
Whether you're just flying or you're working, you're doing whatever, which I think is the first step for an airline to come out and say, you don't fly without a mask, bottom line.
And not to be outdone, JetBlue is making everyone use their vomit bags only once.
There you go.
No sharing.
Thank you very much. Yeah. All right.
You had to get that in.
That's why
he interrupted. Do better.
That's it. Nothing will stop a hack spiewack line. Ever. Ever. You need to get cinder blocks and trowel him in to do it. I was simply going to say I had a memory when you were saying that of why I got pissed off at the Costco, because the guy that didn't have a mask was whistling when he walked into the store.
Oh, no.
He was whistling with his giant, I don't want to label people from afar, but I know goddamn well who he voted for. And he's walking in going, and I can't whistle. So it's like, it's like, oh, yeah. Okay, we know you don't care. You might as well whistle, you dumb, fat jackass. Thank you. A school in China encouraged kids to social distance from each other by making them wear hats that are 3 feet wide. So that is pretty funny. Picture
like
that if you
cars,
want.
But they're kids.
Four people in Thailand were arrested after they broke into a zoo to feed the animals because they assumed the zoo was letting them starve. Wildlife officials visited the zoo later and confirmed the animals are fine. Well, isn't that nice?
Mm-hmm.
And Florida is in the news. Governor Ron DeSantis is facing heat after he referred to his state, might like him more after this, as God's waiting room because there's so many old people in Florida. Hey, you know what? I'm not going to jump on the guy for saying something that I've said 3,000 times, okay?
Sure.
God's waiting room, always been funny. And now a little something. A dog spotted on the loose in Maine was captured and identified as a family pet that went missing 6 months earlier from a home 50 miles away. Maine Animal Control Officer Dave Townsend said volunteers with Maine Lost Dog Recovery helped him set traps and track the movements of the loose dog spotted wandering the woods recently in the Calais area. Calais, Maine is kind of close to where I am. The canine was successfully caught in a trap late last week, and the 90-pound Great Pyrenees, I've had a couple of these,
wow,
they wander, was identified as Nelly. a dog reported missing 6 months earlier in Addison, Maine, about 50 miles away from where the dog was captured. Townsend said he believes Nellie had wandered 50 miles through the woods on her own with scant food resources for months. Maine Lost Dog Recovery said Nellie was reunited with her owners. When asked to comment, Nellie said, "Well, it's about goddamn time. Jesus, I've been out in these woods looking, hunting berries, for Christ's sake. I'm a domesticated animal. Put me out here. You don't come out and check and see where I went, and I just wandered, and I got lost 50 goddamn miles away. Jesus Christ, you'd think they could get in a goddamn station wagon and come trying to find me. I'm Nellie the Great Pyrenees."
Hey, Nellie.
Yeah.
You feel good now?
Oh, good. There's really only one reason I ran 50 miles away, if you want to know what that was.
What is it?
I was horny. I was big-time horny.
Nellie.
We'll take a break, and we'll come back with more on the Mike O'Mara Show, everybody. God damn it. Welcome back to the Mike O'Mara Show, brought to you by the TMOA Shopping Center. Coronavirus update. Parents are delaying their kids' vaccination wellness visits amid concerns of COVID-19 exposure. Kids are behind on their shots. Meanwhile, parents are doing more shots than ever. He was laughing before the joke was read. Thanks to sheltering in place, scientists say that the largest ever ozone hole has closed. But the governor of Georgia says that he should have it open again by May 15th.
That's funny.
That is very funny. And Kim Jong-un is setting a positive example for his North Korean followers by not only self-quarantining, but by going the extra mile and doing it from a box. Every day it's different, right? With him.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
Alive, not alive, you don't know.
Also, yesterday in Trump's press conference, he said, "We have a very good idea," and then he said, "But nobody knows."
Oh, gloom, despair, and agony on me. You can't even safely shop anymore, or can you? The TMOS Shopping Center. Hit up MikeOMaraShow.com. You'll get Walmart and Target safely from home. The banner's right there. Click it. It helps the show. We would really appreciate it. Make sure that you access them through our banner. The TMOS Shopping Center. Shop from home and help us out. Remember, Mother's Day is May 10th, so remind Mom that she can always buy you something at the TMOS Shopping Center because you care. Let's open up the audio vault for today. This is Tuesday, and this is April 28th, 2020. Take it away, Rob.
Here's our quarantine of the day. Mike, you used to play a lot of Tears for Fears on WAVA, didn't you?
Tears for Fears, baby. Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, I kind of like this one.
Shout, shout, shout it all out. I'm an 80s singer.
This one is called Couch. He's talking to you. Stay home.
Yeah,
not what I thought.
Thank you. All right.
I just like the notion of couch. Bad year, Mike. Bad year for the Doobie Brothers. It's their 50th anniversary. Mm. They had to cancel their sold-out summer tour where they were reuniting with Michael McDonald. Mm-hmm. That's done. They're going to be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction this year. That's canceled. So the Doobie Brothers were about to have their best year, like, since they were a hot band, and right. It's all done. Yesterday, they did a sheltering at home concert where they all played with each other. The Doobie Brothers doing the song Black Water. They still sound pretty good.
Oh, this is them?
Yeah.
I didn't realize that. Why do I think the Doobie Brothers were like a pop band?
Or a pop band?
Like a pot band. Like.
Well, because they have the name Doobie.
Oh.
Well, they certainly were. I mean, they weren't a pot band like Fish or the Grateful Dead, but they were, you know, if you call yourself the Doobie Brothers, that means you
this
like
was
a good...
This more like an acid band, right?
Yeah. Well, the Doobie Brothers were, they're L.A.-based, weren't they?
Yeah, yeah.
An L.A.
And
band.
And also, I love the fact that this is definitely an F.U. to Michael McDonald, because he did a Doobies record by himself on Zoom and put it out there without them. So they choose one of the Doobie Brothers hits that does not have Michael McDonald on it. So I'm sure that there's a lot of good feelings going on there.
By the way, there's some great ones that are not, you know, Michael McDonald was a part of the Doobie Brothers, not essential
no, right.
to it. The early stuff like China Grow. And,
Jesus is just all right.
They have great, great songs. Some of my, probably my, Listen to the Music is not a Michael McDonald song.
One However,
the great, great Doobies records. I love the Doobies prior to Michael McDonald.
The greatest song yesterday that I heard was by Terry Bradshaw. Carrie Bradshaw has recorded a song, and now we are officially off the rails. Okay, this is called Quarantine Crazy.
Now it was fun for a week, I'll admit it, but my cabin fever's about to reach its limit.
I meant to say quarantine crazy. Sorry about that. Got a little mixed up.
Oh, I see. I thought he would say quarantine.
He might in it. I listened to it once this
Not
morning.
Good.
Just knew I had to bring it to here. Now, this I do like. People are going crazy. There's a gentleman. He has a hedgehog named Pepper, and he has set up an obstacle course in his living room with pool noodles and cushions from his couch, and he covers hedgehog like he's on American Ninja Warrior. And you need to see the video to really appreciate it, but he captures the flavor of American Ninja Warrior very well. So this is Hedgehog, Pepper the Hedgehog in an obstacle course.
Way pretty quickly to the double barrel bridge, Bob. Incidentally, besides being the quickest way to the love seat, it's the only way to the love seat. So good on you, Pepper. She's zipping across the love seat. That'll help. Down the armrest and towards the final obstacle. And it looks like she's in the final stretch here, folks. She's coming up to the ramp. Now, this has given her trouble in the past. She's been a little bit reluctant, but she has done it. So we'll see if she will
like giving her trouble
now.
In the past.
And yes! Yes, she did it, folks. Good job.
All that Pepper. Stuff works for me. That's just getting through it better than some jive ass song.
Oh,
absolutely. Yeah.
And Mike, we close today with a salute to the lady that had a big bolt of fabric that had tiny penises on it. And she used that to make face masks. And what's so brilliant about it is if someone is close enough to her to see that there are penises on her face mask, they're too close. So it's like a built-in thing. She Amen. Sold out. She sold out all of her face masks, but here she is talking about Project Penis.
I had no idea that so many people would want them, and you can't get them where I ordered them anymore, but we do have the material. It's called Project Penis Mask, and all of the proceeds will go to benefit Utah Harm Reduction Coalition and the folks that we serve there. So many people just don't have a very good sense of humor these days. I just love that there are at least 150,000 people in the world that would also be willing to wear on their face out in public and think that it's hilarious because it is.
So is that a penis on your face or are you just glad to see me?
The thing about it is, and all the proceeds going to a charitable organization because people with great senses of humor do that. That's giving back. Amen to her. I want to see where I can order one.
That is your magic audio vault. Sorry about the JetBlue joke. Have a great Tuesday, everybody.
Well, that's it. We got to get out of here. We'll be back tomorrow. I'll tell you all about Lemon House. That's right, the Lemon House. That's what it's going to be called.
Sorry.
Yeah, absolutely. That's okay. I found
out
what a
magnetron is. Remember when you rented the place, Mike? Place in Maine. Oh,
this is the end of the show. Come on in and say goodbye to everybody, Michael. This is the end of the show. So,
hey, buddy.
Hi.
It's time to say goodbye. What do we have planned today? Nothing. Another day of quarantine with Daddy.
Uh huh.
That's right. Okay. Very good. Say hi, Oscar.
Hi, Oscar.
Say hi, Rob.
Hi, Rob.
Aloha.
And now say goodbye.
Goodbye, duties.
Yes. We got to get out of here. For Rob Spiewak and Oscar Santana, Michael Barra saying so long, everybody. Wait,
bye-bye,
Michael. Wait, bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Oscar?
I'm here.
You didn't say your thing.
Oh, ciao, ciao. Sorry.
Thank you.
I'm waving.
Before you go, please make a mental note. Today's show was made possible by the TMOS bonus packages. You can secure yours right now by going to MikeOMaraShow.com and clicking on the red bonus banner. Buy it or give it. Either way, you're helping out TMOS, and that's a good thing. Thank you, and go in peace.
Mike O'Mara, Radio Entertainment.
Just trying to have a little fun, folks. That's
Should
all.
I tell people that I am a good at sex?
Fat, drunk, and stupid is no way to go through life, sir.
We feel sorry for people who don't drink because when you get up in the morning, that's as good as you're going to feel for the rest of the day.